Thank you very much for the kind introduction. So let me quickly just I'm seeing some students coming in. Feel free to grab a seat. So let me quickly just talk a little bit about this program, or spend about half an hour to introduce a bit about this program here. So quickly, I was being introduced. I'm Justin Law, and just call me Justin is fine. And I'm the Deputy Program Director for the Master of Science in Accounting and Finance Analytics Program. So glad to see you all here to learn more about our program. Besides me, Dr. Tian Feng is also the Program Director of the program. So both of us are managing this program together, not only me, myself there. Both of us are involved a lot in this program. I'm involving more on the operational aspects, and Dr. Feng is involving more on the academic aspect of the program. So if you would like to learn more about the program, and we have a WeChat group being set up, and please feel free to scan this QR code if you have WeChat with you. And we would regularly post certain information to our WeChat group there, and you can certainly learn more about some developments on our program, okay? So that's the agenda, and I'm not gonna go through that because, you know, that's usual. There are many things that I just wanna talk about the business school, about PolyU, a little bit about program, and so on and so forth. So the core values, I think if you sit through a lot of our information seminars, I'm sure you know that the PolyU Business School focus on ideas, right? Or innovation-driven education scholarship, 3D focus on design, discovery, and delivery. Okay, and so that's the core value of our business school, and all the programs that we develop, including this one, accounting and finance analytics, is also tied very much to this particular motto. Okay, we have a very comprehensive business school itself. We have over one of the biggest business school in Asia, over 4,900 students, 54,000 plus alumni, and over 170 plus world-class scholars from around the world as well. So that's essentially tells you that we are not a small business school at all. And in terms of the ranking, certainly we are on a very I cannot say top, but certainly very high end of the league of the league table. So number one, you can see that there's Curate Web of Science, number one in KUBS, and number four in research.com, best science and management universities, and number four in also Shanghai ranking, and so on. So I don't want to read through all this there, but what we want to show is that, you know, our academics are not only good in terms of teaching, but they're also very good in terms of research. So that's why we can be able to rank at such a high, given such a high ranking in our business school. So in terms of accreditations, I think this is all throughout our programs. We are accredited by AACSB and EQUIS. So these are the two major accreditations that we have for all our programs there. I'm sure for those who are familiar with business schools, I mean, you would see these two accreditations that is being signal quality in terms of our program, right? So a little bit about our school, right? We have a longest history, which is established traced back to 1972. And it's also one of the first education provider to provide accounting education in Hong Kong. We have over 90 full-time staff in various areas because it's a school itself. So we have the 90 full-time staff spanning from accounting, finance, auditing, taxation, corporate governance, and business economics, so on and so forth. And so in other words, our colleagues in this school here are very good in terms of integrating these different areas in their education. So now we talk a little bit about the program itself, right? So the first thing is certainly it's that, you know, you're interested to learn about data analytics. So we obviously need to understand, well, why data analytics is so important, right? So, you know, in terms of the nowadays, as you know, data is all around. And how we use that data to create something valuable or add value to the company is something that's important to nowadays organizations. So in terms of advanced big data and data analytics, we have big data analytics there, machine learning, deep learning, AI nowadays, you know, especially generative AI being so important. And if you look at, how businesses see the analytics is that, you know, most companies are, as being quoted here, are struggling to make progress in building data analytics capabilities. 41% of the CEO, you know, said that they are not prepared, and 4% say that they are, you know, they're to a large extent being prepared. So what we, I mean, this is coming from IBM Institute of Business Value in a few years back. And this tells you, in fact, a lot of the data analytics skills are still missing in the business, I mean, in the business industry. So the demand is certainly there. One of the biggest barrier we see is that, you know, we have two types of professionals. One type of professional is they are very good in terms of, you know, the tech part. So in other words, these are the computer science professionals, or those are engineers, engineering background. They are very good in terms of all these technical expertise. But on the other end of the spectrum, we have some who are very good in terms of business. But the thing is, well, do we have a combination of the two? Certainly, this is the way, the reason why we have this program here is to fill that gap. We don't see a lot of the business people who are also very good in terms of knowing the technical aspect of all these like big data analytics. So that's why our program is trying to put this link together so that the students will become business translators who can translate this data savvy, combined data savvy with the industry and functional expertise of the business discipline and also the technical disciplines together in order to help the organization to thrive, right? So this is a very brief schema in terms of how data analytics works, right? So we start off with a bunch of raw data. So raw data comes from many things there, you know, anything that you have in your phone, in your iPad, or even your smartwatch already are gathering data, right? So those raw data, they are obviously quite useless in a sense. That's why you have to use certain ways to turn this data into the very end or the other end of the spectrum whereby it enables business people to make decisions. So this chain whereby from raw data in terms of transforming itself into a decision, it's, you know, something that data analytics obviously all about, right? And so in a sense, that's what you would see down there. It's that, you know, from based on using analytics, we turn data into information. And if you have more analytics, then certainly that data can be more useful to generate what we call knowledge, right? So how is being applied to accounting and how is it being applied to finance? So let me just use two slides to talk about this over here. So this slide essentially talks about from the accounting perspective, because you will notice this program is called Accounting and Finance Analytics, right? So from an accounting perspective, you know, how it's being useful, I mean, to accountants. AICPA is one of the professional organizations in accounting, right? Or one of the professional accounting organizations. So what they're saying is that, you know, the rise in the utilization of computer-assisted auditing techniques or CATs, tax operation, management reporting, wire visualization and dashboards, cloud technologies and automation, it's imperative that accountants has to be proficient in technologies. So in other words, I mean, we are trying to groom not the current generation accountants, but also preparing for future generation accountants that are tech savvy, that can be able to solve future accounting related problems, right? How about from a finance perspective? So for those who are in finance, you certainly learn about CFA, right? You know, and which is the certified financial analyst. So their survey suggests that, you know, over 50% of CFA members see that their firm's top priority is to use tech in their client engagement, right? And machine intelligence, customer-oriented intelligence, and internet security, it will be applied to a lot of investment decisions as well, right? And 72% of respondents believe that, you know, they expect the influence of data technology in decision-making to banks, in investment banks, to be grow in a very significant way. So all these so-called stats are telling us one thing, right? You know, not only that, accountants find analytics being very important, finance firms also find analytics being very important. So that's why we have this program around to solve or to address this issue, right? So the other thing is that, you know, you can see that from Forbes last year, one of their findings is that, you know, the coding AI likely is going to be needed for business-minded people, not only for tech people. That's what they're saying. And also, the global market for data analytics is supposed to be increased by 21.1% on an annual basis. It's not just one shot, right? You know, from 2022 to 2030. So in other words, you're still right in time to catch this wave, right? Again, you know, if you go back to a little bit of a local scene, part of this strategic move in the 14th five-year plan from the central government in China also endorses this, right? You know, this data analytics need. And the Hong Kong government also proactively seeks support for business applications of tech in terms of empowering sustainability and prosperity in Hong Kong. And again, Seb, you can also notice, I mean, for those who are in accounting, you will know what Big Fours are. And for Big Fours, you know, in fact, every Big Four has a data analytics center. So you can see the data analytics centers are so, I mean, data analytics are so important, not only to finance people, but also to accounting people, right? So FinTech 2025 strategy is that the finance sector in Hong Kong is comprehensively adopt FinTech by 2025. So this is another important demand that it's even in Hong Kong itself addressed by the FinTech survey from Hong Kong MA that, you know, we're looking for a lot of talents to transform the financial industry into, you know, through FinTech. So this program, it's launched in 2019, which was about 4 years old, right? And it's the first of its kind in Hong Kong because, you know, this is not only, it's not about FinTech, but it's accounting and finance analytics, right? So it's a tech application or technology application in accounting and finance itself. So it involves things like big data, AI, FinTech, and deep learning. So this is what we are trying to do. Our aim is to provide students with the combination of core knowledge in accounting, finance, skills in applying data analytics and technology. And it facilitates practitioners of accounting and finance to keep the latest data analytics applications and skills. Now, this is very important to stress this. We are not a tech, I mean, based program, and we are not training students to become tech experts. So in other words, students do need to know some aspects about tech, but the more important thing is they need to understand how tech is being applied to solve complex accounting and finance problems. Okay, so that's very different as compared to a computer science or engineering program which addresses this issue. Okay, so our program objectives, I think I pretty much also talked a little bit about that before. So we want to make sure that students are having knowledge or acquire knowledge and skills in data analytics, and we also make sure that students have the core knowledge in both accounting and finance area. And the most important one is certainly how that analytics can be applied to accounting and finance based on, you know, these new tech stuff. And we therefore have systematic training and development of data analytics skills and capabilities in solving business problems in accounting and finance, and also capitalizing this opportunity to offer by big data in solving accounting, finance problems, and also business problems as well. So the key program features, I think you noticed that the word beyond being highlighted. So this program, it's trying to, again, train students beyond traditional accounting and finance knowledge, right? So that's the most important one, because we want to make sure that students understand how accounting and finance knowledge can be enriched by having this understanding of data analytics and advanced technologies, right? And so we hopefully can have the students to apply these advanced computing technologies to solve the business problems that arise in accounting and finance areas, right? So we have therefore offer a full array of activities, which I'll talk about next, in preparing students in reaching this particular program goal. So now let's talk a little bit about the operational details of the program, right? So the mode of that, of the offering, it's a mixed mode. So mixed mode meaning that we have both a combination of a full-time mode and a part-time mode itself. So if there's a full-time option, then you will take over a full-time option. That means you will take over 9 credits or 3 courses in one semester. And if you take a part-time option, then you will do less than 9 credits or 3 courses in one semester, right? And why we have these two modes is all because, you know, that provides flexibility for students who choose to do different modes of study at the same time. So that's the case. Once again, I think I need to stress, if you are on a student visa basis, then you can only opt for the full-time mode, but not the part-time mode there, unfortunately. And the duration of the program, it's the normal study duration is 1 year for full-time and 2 years for part-time. In terms of the class time, it's usually on weekday evening or weekends, right? So that's essentially the case, but we try to arrange it in weekday evening as much as possible. And also we have some weekday daytime classes for the full-time students as well. So the program structure is 10 subjects, 30 credits, and you can also exit by having a postgraduate diploma. Details of that, I don't want to bore you over here, and you can read that through our website, because I think most of the students likely would like to get a master's degree than a postgraduate diploma. Okay. Now, in terms of the program details, you would see right here, we have 9 compulsory subjects and 1 elective, essentially, okay, for that 10 courses. So that 9 subjects of elective, which comprises of 27 credits, you can see right there, out of that 9 courses, 7 of them are being highlighted in blue. Why highlight in blue there? Because they are tech-oriented. Sorry. So in other words, they are not merely related to accounting and finance. They have some tech element involved, or a strong tech element involved in those subjects as well. So that's the reason why it is all related. Sorry. And the other one, 8 and 9, in fact, it's also tech related as well. They are in the sense that you have financial analysis, evaluation programming, and also tech application, accounting finance too. My apology there, the first 7 of them, in fact, it's all because they are needed if you want to get a postgraduate diploma rather than a master's degree. And then you have elective subjects. You can select one of the following subject over here. And you will notice it ranges from some more advanced accounting and finance subjects such as risk management, derivative, fixed income, right? Or you can, if you want some more tech, oriented subject, you can choose artificial intelligence. You can also choose data structures and databases, or you can choose a course on business intelligence and decisions. So that's also, in a sense, allowing students to specialize if they want to do more tech, or you want to do more businesses or accounting and finance in their studies. So the suggested study progression pattern for full-time, as I point out before, is 1 year. And for those students who are taking full-time, naturally they will take 5 courses per semester to complete 10 subjects there. And the elective subject usually is being taken in the second semester, but not the first semester, okay? So that's how the normal progression is for full-time. As for part-time, for students doing in 2 years there, then you just simply, spread out those 10 courses into 2 years. So for first semester in year one, you will take 3 compulsory subjects. And then for the second semester in year one, you also take 2 compulsory and 1 elective. There's certain flexibility in this case. The students can do the elective either in year one or in year two. But in this case here, we are suggesting to do it in year one. And then for year two, they will just two compulsory subjects for first semester, and then finish off with the next 2 compulsory subjects. So let's look at some enrichment activities. Our program has a lot of enrichment activities involved in making students see that, have a very having a comprehensive experience rather than, just attending classes, getting off classes, doing assignments. The first one is the signature Python programming bootcamp. This program, bootcamp program, spans a week-long program whereby students would engage in a review class and reviewing a lot of the Python knowledge that they need for the program there. Once again, we expect students who apply for this program have some basic knowledge in Python. This is supposed to be a refresher to refresh your memory in terms of the Python programming that is being needed for the tech subjects that's being listed in the program. So it's a week-long program there that facilitates students to do this. We also have career preparation workshop, right, for students there. After all, I mean, we do want students to have a job after the graduation there. So every year we do organize a career CV writing workshop there to invite some professionals from outside or in-house to talk about how to get job hunting, CV writing, and so on. Tech workshops, we usually would feature at least two tech workshops every year. So last year we had a workshop on this like AI on, tech transformation on financial industry, okay, or finance and banking industry there. And upcoming, we have a tech workshop on generative AI and financial industry as well, okay? So why we have these tech workshops there? It's all because we invite a lot of the industry professionals to share their views in terms of how tech is being applied to the firms. So not only the fact that students will learn new insights or the latest insights in application of this tech knowledge, but more importantly, it enables them to do networking with the industry professionals. So this is the reason why we have these tech workshops there. So usually we do it one per semester, and sometimes will be more than one per semester. We also arrange field visits. So before COVID, we actually arranged them to visit S3. Okay. So beforehand, so they understand how the government in fact promote fintech or tech in various different areas in Hong Kong. So there are some of these, you know, field visits certainly will be arranged in this program. We are also thinking of doing field visits not only in Hong Kong but also in the Greater Bay Area as well in the future. Starting from this year, we have two things new. For students, we are very glad that we have a so-called professional mentoring program coming in. So the student, our selected students in this program are being matched with mentors, okay, from the industry, so that in fact they will be able to hook them up with the mentors there. The mentors will share with them in terms of how, you know, the latest development of tech and industry is working. And certainly they will be able to offer them a lot of career related advice from those mentors as well. So starting this year, we are having a program there, and currently we have over 30 or 40 students are enjoying this program there. And another exciting one starting from this year is now we are collaborating with Hong Kong MA on another initiative. So Hong Kong MA has an initiative, it's called IPMN Initiative. So the students in this initiative will be joining a project from a real finance company or a banking industry company or company in the banking industry there to do a tech related project. Okay, so this year we had five banks working with us for six projects there, and each project can accommodate two students for each project. So in a sense, this program is very competitive because after all, they have to deliver something that is substantial to that bank or to that particular financial institution. So that's why we are very selective to make sure that students who are interested, who are very keen, that can be able to make it. And that's also have a lot of effort that they have to put in. And we, in fact, embedded this course as part of our program there so that, you know, students completed this or will complete a subject if they complete this course, working with the Hong Kong MA on this initiative as well. So that's another one. So looking at the grad statistics, right, we had, in terms of industry diversity for our graduates, we are also very happy to see that, you know, many of them are working in investment banks or are in audit, okay, in Big Four, or are some, you know, fintech or tech-related firms or regulators, and we also have graduates working in Tencent, okay, and they also work graduates working in investment groups, okay, or commercial banks there. Some of them further their studies into PhDs, okay, and the class profile wise, I mean, the range is ranging from 20 to 40s, and the average work experience is about 2 years there, and the gender ratio, it's a little bit more female than male, slightly more. So if you're interested in this program, what do you need to do, right? Obviously, you can apply, but what's the requirement? We have the minimum requirement for this program is a bachelor's degree, right? So if you have a bachelor's degree, even you have no work experience, you're encouraged to apply. But one of the things that we would like to remind students is that potential applicants is that this is a very competitive program. We have been receiving over 2,000 applications every year. Okay, so that's why, you know, it's very competitive in a sense. If you're interested, do try to apply early there. And if you're not an native English speaker, and also your bachelor's degree is not from a institution that use English as a medium of instruction, then you have the right IELTS tests or TOEFL tests there being listed in the PowerPoint. And also you can check our website to for that particular requirement as well. The intake quota is 150. So the fees is being listed over here for 30 credits. Scholarships will be awarded for outstanding applicants. And also starting from this year, we also have scholarships as well provided for outstanding applicants. Credit transfer, quickly just talk a little bit about this, is that, you know, we only grant credit transfers for previous postgraduate studies relevant to our program. So in other words, undergraduate studies are not applicable for credit transfer in this program, okay? And for the validity of that postgraduate studies has to be 8 years from the year of attainment. And for those who have already got a professional qualification from, you know, a CPA or a CFA, are also eligible to do credit transfer as well. But undergraduate degree is not applicable, unfortunately, okay? We also prefer students who prefer them to have programming background or have some programming related experience, because as you know, this is very important for students to, you know, if you get involved in this program, you do need to do programming, right? So if you're not interested in programming, then, you know, this program, you know, might not be too suitable to you, right? This is important. And usually in the Python programming workshop there, we will notice that, you know, some students find out, you know, programming is something that is quite different than what they've been used to studying. So in a sense, it's not about group work there. In fact, you need to write codes on your own, right? And also debug codes on your own, right? So this is a very important aspect that we would like our students to have, or this attribute is very important aspect for our potential students to have. So if you would like to learn more about the program, then you can contact me or contact Dr. Tian, right? And you can also contact the school admin over here. And email, website, online applications, form in terms of the URL, they're all here. Early applications are strongly encouraged, right? And the deadline, once again, it's April 30th, 2024. So next year for April 30th there. And so I hope that, right on time on this. So I hope that you find the information useful. And now is the time for Q&A. Any questions about the program? No? Well, I will stay around for a few minutes. And if you have any questions, then do let me know. And so I would thank once again for coming to this seminar, and have a very nice day as well. Thank you.